Okay, it's At Love Clark. I'm going to be reading Old Jewels by Marie Sandoz, distant relative of my wife's. We're going to chapter 2. It's been a while since I read this, and I want to keep it up, and I want to give up on it. So, reading chapter 2, Old Jewels. Chapter 2 is called Mirage. Excuse me. The Niobrara, its sand bottom still soft from the flood waters of March, was smaller here than in Knox County. But the current ran swift and strong, and its load of abrasive yellow sand had cut deep through sandstone and volcanic ash and lime rock, bearing bones of mastodon and beds of petrified snails. But the homeseeker had no time for these things today. Jules pounded his thin-necked team through the stream and up a snakehead gully to the horizon-wide hardland table, where the occasional sunflower along the soldier trail reached to his shoulder. He sank his spade two blades deep through the tough nigger wool sod. The soil was black, smooth, smelling of spring. Here the settler dropped the harness from his team. When his fire of diamond willow crackled, he skinned a grouse and fried it all. If a man would plan well, he must eat. His long hands about his ragged knees, he looked into the red fire. Soon, Rosalie would be beside him. Rosalie and neighbors, lights all over the flats, friendly in the dark that was unrelieved tonight. At last, he lay down to sleep. The next morning, Jules took his traps to the river, and while a blue kingfisher poised over the stream, fell like a plummet. He set several number ones where the dainty tracks of a mink embroidered the mud. The two larger traps he hid cunningly where gnawed yellow cottonwood lay half in the water. He caught two muskets, a mink, and two beaver feet chewed off at the steel jaws of the trap. It was too bad to leave an animal crippled to suffer. Before the kerosene that had slopped against the grub box was evaporated and the coffee was tolerable again, Sol Pitcher, a surveyor from Verdurge, drove out of the dusk to the campfire. The two talked over their supper. The cook at Hunter's had said, "You'll find Frenchie scratching the dirt on the flats until July comes to cook his liver and lights." "Trying to discourage settlers," Jules grumbled over a leg of cottontail. "Yeah," Sol admitted, as he wiped the gravy from his catfish mustaches. He liked the country and was disappointed that the impractical Jules had put off finding the government corners of his land while he planted young ash and cottonwood and box elder seedlings from the river. A wave of population was due. There would be money in locating. For 2 days, they plodded their ponies over the table westward from Box Butt to a wide prairie dog town, thousands of little crater holes with the derisive dogs bobbing out of sight with a flirt of the stubby tails to scold and bark as soon as the men were past. Let's pause for a second and read this note. Finding the government corners. The government surveys in this region were completed in 1881. The section corners were marked with four holes, one in each of the cornering sections. The soil thrown together in a central mound and a stake bearing the section number driven into the mound. The Homestead Act effective January 1863, allowed each bona fide settler 160 acres of land. The entry was by legal description, and the entryman swore that he had seen the premise before filing. Squatting had lost all legal status. Okay, let's find where we were. Sorry. For 2 days, they plodded their ponies over the table westward from Box Butte to a wide prairie dog town. Thousands of little crater-like holes with the derisive dogs bobbing out of sight, with a flirt of the stubby tails to scold and to bark as soon as the men were past. Jules shot one to examine it, a gnawer with teeth like a little beaver. He spattered the head of a rattlesnake on one of the mounds, then he saved his ammunition. They found several fine white and buffalo heads, and a few descriptions that lined up with the compass, but no numbered stakes as the government bulletins promised. Hoping that the weather had brought them down, they dug in the holes. Finally, Jules threw the spade from him. Damn the luck! Prairie fire burn me the sticks, or somebody maliciously destroyed them. Yeah, guess you're right, Jewel, the calmer Sol agreed, picking up the spade. The next day, Sol headed north towards the railroad survey, where locating would be more profitable around the new town sites. Three soddies would make a town with lots to sell. After his friend was gone, Mirage Flats was suddenly empty, bare as the burnt-out world. When a small puffball of dust came down the army trail from Fort Robinson, far to the west, Jules leaned with folded arms across the muzzle of his gun beside the deep ruts and watched them trot by. Three light wagons, officers, educated men, with a mounted escort. They barely acknowledged his greeting. Only one more Granger scalp if the Sioux broke out. Back at his wagon, Jules set the rifle against the wheel, poured out a cup of cold coffee from the blackened syrup pail, looking after the troopers until the cloud of dust dipped down towards the Niobrara. Suddenly, he flung the dark liquid and the cup from him and piled his plow, his axe, and his spade into the wagon. In the morning he would go back, not to Estelle and Knox County, not to Neuchâtel and to Zurich, to his friend Serber and Carr, to Rosalie. But that night, while with the point of his pocket knife he probed frying balls of baking powder biscuit and antelope steak gravy, tired hoofbeats pounded over the prairie. A covered wagon broke from the darkness, the leathered flanks of the horses heaving. A man leaped down, deep shadows of night on his naked cheeks. Jules reached for his rifle and stepped back into the darkness. "Don't shoot! My God, man! Don't shoot!" the frightened youth begged. "My wife's dying. I can't find a woman to help her." Suspiciously, Jules came forward, scratching his beard. "And there?" he asked, thumbing towards the wagon. Together they climbed upon the double trees, Jules carrying his lantern and his gun. Inside, between boxes and bundles, lay a young woman, little more than a child, her eyes unmoving, caverns in the light. Jules pushed his cap back and clambered out. He set the pan off and began eating rapidly with his knife, mouthing the hot food, his rifle still in the crook of his arm. Behind him in the shadows hovered the stranger. Once more he searched the dark of the flats, shielding his eyes from the campfire and lantern glare. There was nothing, only those in the circle of the light. "You can't sit there eating and let her die!" Without answering, Jules speared another chunk of steak and put it into his mouth. Slowly, the man plodded to his team and gathered up the lines. "Hey, oh hell, put a bucket of water to boil," Jules ordered. At a hoarse cry from the wagon, he gulped a cup of black coffee and carried the lantern into his tent, his back a black moving shadow. From a small bottle with a red skull and crossbones, he measured the equivalent of a grain of wheat of white powder into a tin cup. "What are you giving her?" the husband whispered. "Morphine. Kill some of the pain. Now make me room and get me some clean rags." While the boxes and bundles came out of the wagon, Jules thumbed through his doctor's book, washed his hands carefully, pared his fingernails close, and pulled his blunt scissors from the boiling water with a stick. Then he carried out the instructions of the book as unfeelingly, as coldly, as though the woman were on one of the animals he had so often seen his veterinarian father care for. The father who still hoped that his eldest of six sons would be a doctor. The woman was spent by long hours of labor and needed all the ingenuity and recollection his Swiss heritage could bring to his strong, narrow hands and the pitifully scant equipment he had. But she had endurance, youth, and courage, and Jules was without knowledge of pain. The horizontal rays of the early sun found the camp asleep. One more potential tiller of the soil on Mirage Flats. And this morning, the discouragement of yesterday was gone. With the help of the younger father, Judd Haskins, Jules unloaded one more and started a donut, a place for his belongings, something to mark his claim. Almost every day, pindots of black broke from the obscurity of the blue-veiled horizon. Only the impression that his place was safely entered protected it from claim jumpers. 2 weeks showed that it was not good with the Haskins baby. Although the younger mother ate much fresh game and every day a bit from the lean store of potatoes and flour, the little Jules cried all night, his mouth like a starving birdling's. The settlers swore and thumbed the doctor's book. Then, one evening, he found a note pinned to his clean blankets. The Haskins hoped to find a doctor and cow's milk at Fort Robinson. The fresh bread hanging from the ridgepole of the tent was for him, and the big jar of grape butter. And God bless him. With a curse, Jules crumpled the note and threw it into the fire. He sat a long time with his hands hanging between his muddy knees. When the clean coffee pot boiled over, he stirred. "Every man need a good woman," he told the flats. Jules wasn't long alone. Homeseekers were drawn to the little tent and the mounds of new dirt. Sometimes they brought news from Valentine, shootings, vigilantes, settlers, and the progress of the railroad west. In return, they got locating help and advice and settled over the flats. Or they moved on to the railroad survey, and when And when that happened, Jules felt a personal defeat. Early in May, a man and his wife, a daughter of 18, shivered through a three-day drizzle at Jules' camp. They laughed at the settler's pan-fried bread and his coffee pounded with a hammer in the corner of a flour sack, but they listened eagerly enough when he talked of preemptions and timber claims and read the Homestead Act to them from the bulletin that was only a mess of little black jiggers on white paper to them. The third evening, Jules brought some of his drying hides, with the animal smell still upon them, into the land seeker's wagon, insisting that the girl stroke the glossy back of the mink, dusky purple brown in the light. "Soft, like samut," he bragged, and brushed the fur quickly to her pale cheek. "Oh," she shuddered, "the awful thing, take it away. Dirty foreigner," the mother called after Jules. But he didn't care. He threw himself on his bed, his hands under his head, his knees up in the darkness, and laughed until he choked. Fine ladies, these, with no family, no education, nothing. The next morning, the world glistened with the blue white of a new snow under the hot sun. Instead of the covered wagon of the homeseekers, there was only a blackish, bare spot with two dark tracks leading away to the south across the level country headed back to Kansas. The girl then was gone. He had dreamed last night as a young lover's dreams of Rosalie, the dark curls of her hair, neck soft under his fingers. Thinking of her, he kicked the snow into the wheel tracks. Perhaps this was Sunday, and they should be walking in the leafing woods. He and Rosalie, the mosses green and springy underfoot, but he was hungry. Never forehanded, the storm caught him without firewood. His team, too, was gone. His horse, Jim, tired of cropping nigger wool roots, pulled up. There's Matt away just for a second. Pulled up the ash stake and foraged for himself. The teammate followed with his shotgun across his forearm. Jules started over the prairie towards the river where the horses, dragging the ropes Indian fashion, were probably sunning themselves. He cursed them. Estelle, his family, even Rosalie. His stomach still growled and the sun on the snow burned his eyes to a lightish gray. At the edge of a bluff, he stumbled over a stake, a corner stake, blurred but with the numbers still discernible. The horses forgotten, he freed the needle of his pocket compass and stepped off the line towards his camp, each step 1 yard north and east. The sun climbed, faint curls of steam twisted upward from the bluffs. Mirage flats began to shimmer as sun on water. Only when he had the numbers of his claim did the homeseeker look up. It was noon. The snow was gone, and bobolinks rose from the prairies, spiraling into the air until they were only specks against the light sky. Raining melody as they coasted to the earth. Cap pushed back, Jules listened and sang a song of his student days in Zurich. Once more everything was good. His first week on the running water, the settler made friends with a party of Aglala Sioux. He was dipping a keg of water from the shallow stream as they galloped through a break in the buffalo berry brush. their half-naked bodies dark against the silvery thicket. "How?" they called. The white man straightened up and answered, "How?" as he watched them. At his greeting, the last of the Indians stopped. "Frenchman," he shouted, white teeth gleaming. He wore a pair of white man's pants with the seat cut out, moccasins, and a red-tipped feather in his hair. A lean, straight young figure on a bay and a white calico pony. The entire string whirled their ponies into a circle about the settler, rested their rifles across their horses, and nodded their approval of this supposed Frenchman. Through the young Indian White Eye, they indicated their camp was across the river. That evening, Jules rode into the Sioux broken circle of the teepees set among the hackberry and box elders at the foot of the Indian hill. White Eye led him to a large fire where most of the men squatted about in blankets smoking. They greeted the white man with raised palms, offered him the fragrant pipe ornamented with a lock of long yellow hair, and asked where he came from. An old man, wrinkled as last year's potato, nodded. He had been to the Missouri. It was far, many sleep. They made their friend welcome on the running water. The Oglalas told Jules many things about the country, the winters, the summers, the hunting. They spoke slowly, sadly, of the buffalo days, when the great herds spread northward, as Jules' father spoke of the age of Pericles. Now the buffalo were no more. One, two, on the Snake and the Sandhills, and then it is done. As they talked, children raced through the camp with bows and horseweed lances, dogs barking, women in red or blue calico and bordered blankets falling to the beaded moccasins cooked over smaller fires. Some turned thick cornmeal cake from one frying pan into another. Some stirred messes in huge government kettles. Some stirred dark messes in huge government kettles until the Oglalas reached to their reservation, Pine Ridge, in June. Jules went often to the camping ground and no man knew how long. Twice he picked eagles out of the sky for them. In return for the wing fans the old men liked and the fine breath feathers for their headdresses, they gave Jules the covered army kettle, laughing deep in their blanket when he asked, "Where come from?" They offered the white man half of the camp property for his German buckshot mold. He parted with it reluctantly for a light saddle, which he needed most urgently, and they apparently hardly at all. From the Indians, Jules learned to guide old Jim with his knees, leaving both hands free for the rifle. They taught him weather and game sign, sharpening his ears and his eyes as a fine stone whets a blade of steel. They took him to Deer Creek, one sleep away at the edge of the deep hills on a hunt. Their ponies loped untiringly over the low swells, through chop hills, and out into a tiny bunch grass valley between soapweed studded sand buttes, and seemed to move aside as the hunters approached. They climbed their horses up Deer Hill, so called because buck brush grew almost to the bald towering top. Resting at the edge of the blowout, a deep crater sifting yellow sand down the slope in high winds, they looked off to the lower hills, shouldering each other into the horizon in every direction. To the east, the Agala said, was the land of the gone before ones, with many hundred elk in the winter, antelope the year round, deer in every brush patch, clear lakes for the washing of the hides, and sand cherries, plums, and choke cherries for the women. But it was not good to go there before the death song. Why not? Jules demanded. No one knew. Strange things happened to those who went. If they came back, the tongue was twisted, and none could understand. Jules looked with interest at the rounded hill, contours blurring to the far horizon, there away to the east, where a tiny bit of lake gleamed blue-white between high, well-grassed ridges. One might find quiet and peace and rest when age slowed the blood and the children were grown. But it would be bad in a blizzard. He remembered the story the freighter told him of the man with hands and feet rotting, crazy as a shitpoke, which seemed to be a queer bird that rose heavily from the rushes along the Niobrara and made the peculiar pumping noise in the evening. Thunder Pumper, Soul Pitcher called him. At Deer Creek, a winding little stream with slow grass almost meeting over the clear thread of water, they camped. Towards evening, the women came in, some horseback, bobbing like rolled feather ticks on the loping ponies, the others in two government wagons. The next day, the hunters killed 15 antelope and 3 buck deer, 2 of the deer and 4 antelopes falling before the Vitrelli. Straight Eye, the Indians called Jules as they squatted about the fire of fast disappearing buffalo chips. The woman stripped the meat and threw it on the drying racks that they fetched with them. Laughing, a tall girl offered to cure some for the watching white man. She was light brown, her eyes soft, her body not too compacted by reservation diet for this Jules. Tell her I am married, he said. A quick laugh followed White Eye's interpretation and a long silence. Uneasily, Jules picked up his Vitrelli and went to the picketed horses. At a grunt from the older man, White Eye brought him back. It was only the kindness due to a guest in the teepee of an Agala. In marriage, she would have a chief bring her father many horses. Jules was glad to be taken back. It was nearing night. Old Jim was tired and Jules himself stiff with the saddle wolf. To show his self-sufficiency, he salted a piece of tinder meat to preserve it. By the next morning, the sand under the sack was browned with the precious juices that are strength. The women saw and among themselves made the sad, kindly noises of a friendly flock of chickens. On the way back, the Indians stopped on a particularly rough spot where the chop hills lay like dun waves of a storm-tossed sea, caught and held forever in naked wind-pot knobs. Green yuccas crowded toward the higher hills like dark sheep running before a storm. And in the hollows were tight sub-sized nest of ball-tongue cactus, the sections broader than a man's hand's width. Running water which way? White Eye asked. Joel squinted for the sun, but there was none, only a high, opaque sky blanketing. He reached for his compass, but the leader held up his hand, palm out, and made peculiar digging motions. Then Jules laughed with them. Every hollow, every blowout, scooped by the wind, pointed away in the same direction, the southeast. Sakra, never get lost in this country. Sakri, never get lost in this country. Between hunts and helping settlers find corners and lines, Jules worked at his dugout, two-thirds in the ground, roofed with sod over straight ash poles. He tried breaking his own ground, but found that it was not easy to manage a team and hold the plow in a nigger wool sod. It jerked and backed the handles, pounded, his legs blistered, his hands, and there was no smooth band of black behind him, only torn, twisted strings of sod that would not turn or flatten. "Takes a strong back," he consoled himself, "and a thick head." After that, Jules began to charge a locating fee, one day of breaking. On the new ground, he planted corn or beans with a spade, striking the blade into the ground once at every step, dropping the seed and closing the groove with his foot as he walked. Cut deep, cut, drop, step, up and down the field. Not at all the home seekers who came stayed. Some ignominiously returned to their relatives. Others pushed on to the less Others pushed on to the greener fields beyond the horizon. More wood and water, less isolation and work. One evening, as Jules was skinning a broad striped skunk beside his tent, two covered wagons came up the soldier trail. They sought a turnoff north. "No road, no travel that way," the locator told them shortly, busy cutting around the scent bag of the animal. "Better land here and plenty game along the river." "Maybe, but that's they's talk of the railroad coming through, and the women folks wants to live close to town." The driver of the first wagon spit a brownish splotch into the greening grass and swung a long whip over his team. The dry wheels squeaked forward. Two women looked through the round hole in the back of the second wagon, holding their noses. In disdain, Jules flung the carcass after them. The influx of settlers meant talk on politics and science and the news. Outsiders brought reports of a panic in New York, the failure of the Marine Bank, the nomination of J. Gold's Blaine on the Republican ticket, and Cleveland, the exponent of civil services to Jules, on the Democratic. The country was evidently going to the dogs again. Corruption in high places, railroads taking all the little fellow could scratch together. But nevertheless, the settlers watched with impatience the slow westward creep of steel from Valentine. Gradually, the home seekers formed the habit of dropping in at the dugout. They hunched themselves on boxes of provisions and ammunition, whittled, pared their nails with their knives, looked at Jules' books, science, medicine, geography, or history, thumbed the mail order catalog, or just talked. Now and then, Jules moved the lantern from its place on the Nebraska statutes to settle some point. On special occasions, he opened his big brown stamp album, kept in the box on the ridgepole with his drugs and poisons. With hands carefully washed in water that must be carried from the Niobrara, he examined any loose stamps under magnifying glass, held them to the light to catch the water marking, and fixed them into place. Someday, he would fill the gaps, most of them. Every time he followed a departing guest into the night for a neighborly last word, the dozens of lights blinking out on Mirage Flats reminded him that the country was settling fast. Soon, there would be land fights. Before he drove the 150 miles to Valentine, Jules spent a whole day writing letters, driving his pen in a strong, harsh slant across the page. His brothers and his uncles in Switzerland must know of this land that fit the shoulder like a well-cut coat. Here there were sunsets rivaling anything he'd ever seen in Italy, and land that needed no manure carried it to it on bent back. To Rosalie he wrote another letter. Surely she would come now and quickly. He did not tell her of Estelle, but wrote of the fine thunderheads here rising into the sky with more magnificence to him than the Jura of his childhood, and of the mushrooms in the woods, food for a king. At Valentine, Jules filed immediately, even before he had a glass of beer, for the homeseeker trails into a frontier land office town were deep and worn. There were two letters, one from his sister Elvina. Papa still hoped for a doctor in the family. Rosalie wrote as ever, but nowhere did she promise to come. Jules traded his supplies, his spring catch of hides, and a couple of eagles he shot on the way down. The eagles sold well. The hides the trader threw into a pile on the greasy counter. Springy catch too late. Not worth much. See that green spot? The trader pointed to a dark stain in the skin on the flesh side. That means a thin hide. Catch them in cold wind weather when the skin's prime. And you better scrap the fat off the badgers next time. Dry better, look better. Must have been a good winter up the river, them animals coming out so greasy. A good year for the skunk and badger oil. Fry it out. Bring you a little money, too. That evening, Jules turned in at the saloon where he had seen the youth killed. It was jammed with more gambling and louder women. Oh, Frenchie. God, but you're getting to be a dirty cuss. Ain't they no water out there, out west? Asked the old freighter at the identical table, still twisting his fingers into his mustache ends as though he hadn't moved. Water is for crops and cows, Jules said. Every drop he used was carried a mile and a half. He ordered the beers and got the news in return. A couple of killings in town, nothing special. Just settlers fighting over entries. Looked like Sheriff Carter was going to leave the country, maybe feet first. Several of the vigilantes from down the Niobrara were out on bail, charged with doing considerable horse stealing on the side. Every day, strings of wagons went west, and every day the drags came back. 20,000 head of young stock trailed through in 1 week. "Is that so?" Joel scratched his beard and forgot his drink. "Looks like the cattlemen intend to hog the country." "Yes? Yeah, it's their meat," the freighter said, twisting the uncurling mustaches hopefully. "Like hell. It's the country of the poor man with a gun," Joel's roared, his rifle across his arm. He stalked away through the crowd, stopping here and there before men who might be looking for land, telling them of the Mirage Flats. Three young men from Iowa promised to come as soon as their outfits pulled in on the unreliable freight. The man with the Winchester was nowhere in Valentine. At the post office, Jules wrote another half dozen letters to his countrymen at Verdurge, a general letter to the Swiss-American publications in the East, and one to a paper reaching the middle class in Neuchâtel, urging all who wanted land to come, and come quickly. The letter to Rosalie he opened again and added a postscript: "If you do not come now, it will be too late." And as he sealed the envelope with the men carrying the young tree, he meant all of it. When he ordered his mail held until called for, even if that were 6 months, the postmaster offered to send out with that of the new colony under Reverend Scammerhorn west along the survey somewhere. The parson would soon have a post office in Gordon. Until then, he got his mail at the Newman Ranch. I don't risk my life going to the Newmans or any other ranch," Jules said flatly. Nor did he intend to go to Gordon for it. He wrote to Washington asking that a post office be established on southeast quarter of the section there, Township 29, Range 45 West. That done, he set out for Mirage Flats and home. In his eagerness, he forgot to have his kerosene can filled, and he drove his team even harder than before. End chapter 2. Chapter 3 is called Jest and Departure. This is chapter 2 of Old Jules. And I hope you enjoyed the reading and hope you could understand everything. I'm going to take a look at the map. See Sandoz Orchard to Wounded Knee to Bighorns. Sketch map, Old Jules. All right, it's at Love Clark, and this is chapter 2 called Mirage.